Merry Christmas. Welcome. I want to welcome you all to the First Congregational Church of St. Albans. My name is the Reverend Jessica Moore, and I'm joined today by Erin Grainger, our music director, and the First Congregational Church Choir, joined by Stephan, our organist and pianist, Lane McElree and Greg Beeman are our videographers today. And not only is it Christmas Eve, but our church got it together 21 months into the pandemic to live stream. So today is our very first live stream on YouTube, so I'm very excited. The First Congregational Church is open and affirming, and that's a member of the United Church of Christ. Open and affirming means that we believe that all people are created in God's image and are loved, valued, and blessed equally by God. And we welcome all people, including those of all races, ethnicity, ages, sexual orientation, gender identity, family structures, faith backgrounds, ability, economic circumstances, regardless. Everyone is welcome here into the life of the church. And please know that no matter where you are in life's journey, you're welcome here to travel with us. So just a COVID note, please keep your masks on during the service. You'll note that I'm actually behind plexiglass, kind of like the Pope. During the service, we'll have lessons and carols. Please do not sing the carols. The choir will take the carols for us. At the end of the service, we'll all light our candles, we'll listen to Silent Night, we'll head outside, and Stephan will really crank on the organ, and we're going to sing Joy to the World together outside. So we'll hold on for that, and it should be a lot of fun. If you would please join me in the spirit of prayer for our evening prayer. This night is one of profound mystery, a night for unusual sounds and sights in the heavens. This night is one of wonderful clarity, a night for the blessed event of our Savior birth into this world. This night is one of far-reaching complexity. Night was crowded into a stable, and kings starting on a journey. This night is one of touching simplicity, a night for receiving a gift and cradling God's love in our hearts. We gather to worship on this best of all nights. I'll now invite Paula and Greg to do the Advent candle while the choir sings, O Come Advent.
When the world seems predictable, stuck in patterns of injustice and hurt, the holy astonishes us with good news, and we find awe. where in the world do we know awe these days?
Our first scripture reading on this holy night is the prophecy of Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 2 through 7. People who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them the light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of the oppressor, you have broken, as in the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born to us, a son has been given. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onwards and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
The second reading is by Sandy Cristman.
This reading's from Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 38. Gabriel visits Mary. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High and the Lord God, and will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there will be no end. Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the son to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her.
Our third reading is by Erin Grainger.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David, called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
Thank you.
Our fourth reading, Lane McElree.
Good evening. Luke 2:8-16. Angels and shepherds adore Jesus. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. When an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around him, and they were terrified. But the angels said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with great the angel multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on the earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and had gone into the heavens, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and to see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger.
Final reading, Stephen McLaughlin.
Now we hear from Matthew, chapter 2. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road.
I cut my teeth in children's ministry, and we used to do live creche scenes during Christmas Eve service. And I had one fellow for years who loved to be a wise man, but he insisted on calling them wise guys. He'd be like, "I want to be a wise guy." All right. Please join me in the spirit of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O God, my strength and my redeemer. I feel like I should rename my sermon something along the lines of "O Holy Omicron." I find it unbelievable that after all this time, we are still in the midst of COVID. From the beginning, and I remember washing all of my groceries, obsessively washing my hands and searching out hand sanitizer, isolating from my neighbors, separated from family. So then we had this hope and the reality of the vaccine and a glimpse of normal life this summer, only to be squelched by Delta and now Omicron. Oh God, we are so weary. And we really need a little light and a little glimpse of the holy, a little connection and a little relief. I have colleagues whose churches have had to make the difficult, painful decision to cancel their Christmas Eve services, really up to the last minute, which is so sad. Because Christmas is full of hope, joy, and love. And when we celebrate together, it soothes our weary souls and our pandemic-fatigued souls really need soothing. We need the rest and the balm that only hope and love and joy can bring. And quite frankly, I'm tired of talking about COVID, but it's still here. It's still our reality, and it's still wearing on us. And it seems to have exacerbated the already growing tensions and division in our society. Civil discourse seems to be, I don't know, some old, quaint notion from some time so long ago. I definitely fear for our society, the growing division, this growing division, it gives birth to things like a strong Christian nationalist movement, partisan politics, and disinterest to climate disaster. Even here in picture-perfect Vermont, tensions and stress is high, and it puts friendliness at a premium. This past year, we've experienced everything from anti-Semitic and white supremacist images posted around town to violent arguments over masking at school board meetings, to absolute vitriol and threats which shut down a public community-wide conversation. So much for loving our neighbors, let alone loving our enemies. Sometimes I wonder in my children's ministry and my Bible studies if when we talk about loving our neighbor, we focus too much on the ever-expanding, far-reaching neighbor that we've actually forgot that we need to love our physical next-door neighbor. Living at loggerheads with our sisters and brothers within our community is not just unpleasant. It's not just adversarial, it is dangerous. It is not how we thrive as a society. And the atmosphere is kind of catchy. I was at Hannaford the other day and I was waiting my time in line at the checkout. And a woman came up behind me and she started looking at me. And I looked at her and I thought, man, she's giving me a funny look. So I had my mask on and I was trying to smile at her, which is obviously difficult in a mask. So what I have found that I do is I squint. Because I figure if I smile really big, my eyes will squint and she'll think that I'm smiling if she sees my eyes squinting. And as I was doing this absurd thing, trying to smile with my eyes, I realized that she didn't have a mask and I thought for a moment, oh, that's kind of interesting. It doesn't bother me that she doesn't wear a mask. But I thought, well, oh my gosh, is she a Karen? Is she going to yell at me and start making fun of me for wearing a mask? My turn came up, I started putting my stuff on the conveyor belt, and in my mind, in those negative gyrations of my mind, I'm like, I'm gonna think of something to say when she says that to me. I'm gonna come back, I'm gonna have something, I'll be prepared. And I was wondering, really, I wonder if she'll have the nerve to say something to me. It'll be interesting. And I'm putting my stuff up and suddenly I hear this voice behind me say, is that a real leather jacket? I love leather. It looks really good on you. Leather looks terrible on me. I don't have anything leather, well, except for my pocketbook. So I was prepared for anything, but I was not prepared for that. And I found myself immediately wanting to tell her the story of my leather jacket. And I have a beautiful leather jacket, and it was given to me by the husband of a late friend. And when we were coming to Vermont, he gave me the jacket and said, you're gonna need this to block those icy winds that come off that lake up in northern Vermont there. But what I said was, I like your hat. It looks really warm and I really like the braids. And she said, it has a pom-pom too. And in that moment of friendliness, I made a new friend. There was no battle. There was no Karen moment. Just friendliness, kindness, and love. And all of that broke through my bleak negative thoughts, breaking through my judgment and breaking through my paranoia. And I can tell you, it was humbling. Here in the everydayness, the routineness, the humdrumness of the supermarket, a shaft of light, a connection, a moment of holy shared community and humanity. It was a little blessed relief from the barrage of negativity, stress, and unpleasantness that seems to rule our society. Those ordinary moments of human connection are what create the basis of the beloved community. The kingdom of God is always, always at hand. And these moments of connection and love, they awaken us to that. They are the moments that remind us that we are not it. We are not the center of the universe. We are a part of it. We are a part of the universe, a part of creation, and we are all a part of creation. God moments, those moments. And those moments won't be found on social media or in conscribed conversations or in the halls of power where money rules and abuses all. Those ordinary moments where light and God break through, happen all around us in the everydayness. And that's the essence of the Christmas story. Light and God breaking through in the midst of everyday life, in the midst of the everyday life of a poor, young, unmarried girl who must give birth in a barn, in the everyday life of humble shepherds who tend, care, and watch over their flock, night after night after night. At night, in the darkness, the light breaks through. Jesus arrives not to the fanfare and privilege of a prince. There is no court physician in attendance. Jesus arrives in the midst of everyday life of a poor couple in a barn, attended by the animals. Jesus enters the world in the very midst of God's creation, a part of creation just like us. For the earth, it was covered in darkness. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God said, "That is very good." Amen. ask the ushers to come up for the candle lighting. And as they're coming up, I have a lot of instructions, so listen up. We'll now be sharing the light with the world. We will light our candles. The choir will sing Silent Night. I will give the benediction. Then we will take our candles outside, where we will sing Joy to the World together. And I see you're already all cued. You're all putting your coats on. That's what I wanted to say. Put your coats on before we light candles. It's easier. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. And everything that came into being came through him, and without him, nothing came into being. And what came with him into being was life, and he was the light of the people. And it shines in the darkness, and the darkness will not defeat it. Amen. Join me outside. Yeah, you just go right on out.